morning. We welcome you here to Earl Street Baptist Church on this beautiful Sunday morning. We are so glad that you are here to worship with us. If you're a guest with us this morning, we invite you to look in front of you in the pew pocket. There are guest cards located there. We would encourage you to take one of those guest cards out, to fill it out, and then drop it in the offering plate when it's passed later on this morning in the service. We are just so glad that you are here to worship with us this morning. This is the first Sunday in August, and some of you may not know that the first Sunday of every month we do blood pressure screenings. They start at 8:45 in the morning and they go until noon, and we have traditionally done it downstairs in one of the rooms in the fellowship hall, but because we have the new building open now, the blood pressure screenings are taking place in what is now the new room 200. It's located in the new building. It's on the second floor behind the new elevator, and it is a smaller conference room. So blood pressure screenings are taking place in there this morning. If you feel like you need to have your blood pressure checked, or Stephen gets you really worked up this morning and you need to go by after the service, get your blood pressure checked, just know that they're down there on the second floor in that small conference room. We do invite you to come back this afternoon at 3 o'clock. We will be having a very special concert here in the sanctuary. It's going to be by Erica Powell. Erica is a Furman graduate. She's a former Miss South Carolina, and she sings with the New York Chorale Artists. She will be giving a concert of popular show tunes, and I got the pleasure of hearing her practice earlier in the week, and you will not be disappointed, I promise you. I heard her outside and came in to listen for a few minutes, and she has a beautiful voice. You will love hearing her this afternoon. And then immediately following the concert, it's again at 3 o'clock here in the sanctuary, we're going to be having our annual ice cream social downstairs in the fellowship hall. So you can enjoy a great afternoon of music. You can go down and have ice cream. It's a great way to beat the heat on this hot Sunday afternoon here in August. The concert is free, but it is a benefit to benefit the capital campaign. So while there's no cost to come to the concert, we would appreciate any gifts and all gifts that can be made to the capital campaign. Next Sunday evening, we will be having deacon ordination service. It'll be at 5 o'clock here in the sanctuary. We elected deacons back in June, and we have two deacons that need to be ordained. So that service will be next Sunday evening at 5 o'clock here in the sanctuary with a reception to follow. So we hope you'll be here for that. And then last but not least, 2 weeks from last night on August the 18th, we're going to be having our game night. We did this last year when we were not able to have our annual 4th of July event, and it was a huge success. So this year, we're expanding it. We're adding more games. We're adding more foods. There's a variety of different foods and desserts that you can have. And so we want you to be sure and come. There's more information on the front page of this week's newsletter about game night, but it'll be 2 weeks from last night. It's August the 18th, and it's from 6 until 8 o'clock in the evening. Make sure you read that article, and then you're here to participate in that. You'll have a great time, I promise. Now, as we move into our time of worship, if you'll take this opportunity to check your cell phones, make sure you have them on vibrate or have them on silent.
Thank you. please join me in our call to worship? Let us be honest this morning.
We have sinned.
We try to pretend that we haven't.
Or we rationalize that others do it more than we.
But the truth is,
we have sinned.
We do or say or think judgmental things.
We fail to respond to an obvious need.
We want what is not ours.
The list is long, and regardless of what is on it,
all that matters is that we have sinned.
Lord, you, in your great mercy, will forgive each of us from every sin if we turn to you.
For your grace is greater than all of our sins. Sovereign God, we gather before you and with you this morning to worship you, to give you praise and glory. We acknowledge the many ways we have failed you and each other. You know us so well. There is nothing we do that is beyond your knowledge, and yet there is nothing we do that is beyond your grace. You know us so well, and yet you love us so much. Your grace is indeed greater than all our sins, and we are so thankful. Make each of us an instrument of your grace. Weave us together into a community that shares your truth and love and tenderness and forgiveness. In the name of Jesus, accept our praise and thanks and worship today and every day of our lives, for you alone are worthy. Amen.
Thank you.
boys and girls. How are you today? Good. We're going to talk about David a little bit today, but first I want to tell you about something that happened to me when I was a little girl. Okay? Once upon a time, my family got new furniture, and it was a light-colored furniture. So naturally, my mom wanted us to take good care of it. She didn't want us to play on it. She didn't want us to eat on it because she wanted to keep it looking new for as long as possible. Well, one day when my mom wasn't home and my dad was in another room, my sister and I decided to eat popsicles. And not just any popsicles, but red popsicles. And we didn't eat them outside and we didn't eat them at the table like we should have. We ate them on the new furniture. Good morning. Well, what do you think happened? That's right. We got down to the melty end of the popsicle, and it fell right smack into the middle of the brand new chair. And there we were. We knew we had made a mistake, and we panicked. So the first thing we thought we would do is get some water, and we would scrub that stain, but that did not make any difference. I think it might have made it worse. Then we got some cleaner, and we sprayed the cleaner on, and we scrubbed it. And all we ended up doing there was bleaching it. So now we had a white spot on the chair with a little red spot in the middle. And the only thing we could think to do as we panicked was flip the cushion over and hope that nobody found out our secret. Do you think somebody found out our secret? Do you think we got in trouble? We did. And if we had just admitted what we had done wrong from the beginning, it probably wouldn't have been that big of a deal. Same thing happened to David in the Bible. He made a big mistake, and instead of admitting what he did wrong, he tried to cover it up. He lied, he hurt other people, and he took his first problem and made it much bigger. It's kind of like when you throw a rock into a pond. What happens when you throw a rock in a pond? It sinks, and what happens around it? We have ripples, and those ripples get bigger and bigger and bigger. And when we try to cover up our mistakes, that's kind of what happens. Let's see what that looks like. And I'm sorry everybody else can't see this. But this is our pond, and this is our stone. So let's think about what happened to me. The first mistake I made was eating on the new furniture. So that was the first mistake I made. But then, let's see what those ripples look like. Then I spilled the popsicle on the furniture. Then I tried to fix it with water. Then I tried to fix it with cleaner and I bleached the fabric. Then I ended up flipping the cushion and hoping that nobody would find out. Now look what happened. Look how small this is and how big this ripple is. So from trying to cover up my mistake, I took a small problem and made it a much bigger problem. And that's what happened to David. But here's the good news. There is no mistake we can make that's too big for God to not love us anymore and to not forgive us for what we do wrong. That was true for David, and that's true for us. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for these children. Thank you for taking care of us. And thank you for loving us and forgiving us no matter how big of a mistake we make. Amen.
It is well. Would you join me in prayer? Father God, we first come to you to ask you to quieten our hearts and prepare us for this time of giving our offerings back to you. Help us to remember how thankful we are as we prepared our gifts, how you've blessed us with all the blessings of life, the blessings so that we can give back to you as much as we can. Father God, I now ask you to take these offerings, and you know best where they need to be used. And so we pray, Father, for your guidance in the use of them. We know that people are waiting to hear your word, and may these offerings help us to do that. I ask these things, Father, in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
continue our summer sermon series that we're calling Building a Kingdom with Flawed Stones. And we pick up the reading this morning in 2 Samuel chapter 11, beginning with verse 1. As I read these words of scripture, I invite you to listen for God's word for you. In the spring of the year, the time when kings go out to battle, David sent Joab with his officers and all Israel with him. They ravaged the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah, but David remained at Jerusalem. It happened one late afternoon when David rose from his couch and was walking about on the roof of the king's house that he saw from a roof a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful. David sent someone to inquire about the woman. It was reported, "This is Bathsheba, daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite." So David sent messengers to get her, and she came to him, and he lay with her. Now she was purifying herself. Then she returned to her house. The woman conceived, and she sent and told David, "I am pregnant." So David sent word to Joab, "Send me Uriah the Hittite." And Joab sent Uriah to David. When Uriah came to him, David asked how Joab and the people fared and how the war was going. Then David said to Uriah, "Go down to your house and wash your feet." Uriah went out of the king's house, and there followed him a present from the king. But Uriah slept at the entrance of the king's house with all the servants of his lord and did not go down to his house. When they told David, "Uriah did not go down to his house," David said to Uriah, "You have just come from a journey. Why did you not go down to your house?" Uriah said to David, "The ark and Israel and Judah remain in booths, and my lord Joab and the servants of my lord are camping in the open field. Shall I then go to my house to eat and to drink and to lie with my wife? As you live and as your soul lives, I will not do such a thing." Then David said to Uriah, "Remain here today also, and tomorrow I will send you back." So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day. On the next day, David invited him to eat and drink in his presence and made him drunk. And in the evening, he went out to lie on his couch with the servants of his lord, but he still did not go down to his house. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. In the letter, he wrote, "Set Uriah in the forefront of the hardest fighting and then draw back from him so that he may be struck down and die." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, after reading this passage, I feel like instead of saying this is the word of the Lord, we should say, and these are the days of our lives. Or these are the young and the restless. Or as my daddy used to say, the young and the reckless. But this is the word of the Lord. What makes the Bible so believable is that it does not idealize the people of God. It does not even idealize the heroes of our faith. The Bible makes it clear from the very beginning that all God has to work with are sinful, flawed human beings. And the fact that God uses any of us is a tribute to God's grace. And the fact that David occupied such a prominent place in the story of God's people tells us a lot more about the character of God than it does about the character of David. This story is the word of the Lord, but it still has all the makings of a soap opera. There is lust and adultery resulting in an untimely pregnancy, questions about the father of the child, deception and corruption at the highest levels of government, conspiracy, war, and eventually death. Sin is sin, and it is serious in and of itself. And yet what so often makes the sin even worse is the cover-up. As Bethany demonstrated in the children's sermon, and by the way, I hate it when the children's sermon is better than the big people's sermon. But as she demonstrated in the children's sermon, if you think of sin as
a rock that's dropped into the water, the cover-up is like the ripples. One sin, unconfessed and covered up, always leads to another. One bad choice leads to another bad choice, worse than the first. I, like Bethany, have my own childhood mischief story, and this is one that I cannot blame on my brothers, although I could find a way if you gave me enough time. I think it was just maybe their evil influence on me. But as many of you know, some of you may not know this, I am extremely bright. And one day I was playing in the dining room, which already gives you a little bit of a clue about how smart I am, and I broke a piece of my mother's fine china. And because I was so bright, I knew that my mother would take a dim view of that incident. And if my father found out, he would speak those dreaded words that would put the fear of God in me: "You better give your heart to Jesus, because the rest is mine." So I knew I better act fast to cover up the damage done. So I found the super glue and tried to glue the broken pieces back together. But I accidentally got a glob of glue on the nicely varnished dining room table. But again, I was bright enough to know that I needed to wipe it off quickly before it dried. So I got a cotton ball and tried to wipe off the glue, and the cotton stuck on the nicely varnished tabletop. But then again, my intelligence paid off. So I remembered hearing somewhere that nail polish remover would neutralize the stickiness of the glue. So I doused the glue spot with it, only to find out that nail polish does not actually remove glue, but it works wonders on removing varnish. Well, I won't bore you with the details of what happened next. I will just tell you that I did give my heart to Jesus one more time, and my dad did get the rest. These kinds of stories are entertaining when they involve super glue and nail polish remover, although it didn't seem all that entertaining to me at the time. But when these stories like that involve real people and the destinies of human beings, these stories very quickly become much more serious and much more tragic. When we pick up the story in this week's lesson, reader's discretion is advised. And it's when life is going well. Have you noticed this? It's when life is going well that we are the most vulnerable. Up to this point, David had lived a charmed life. But we are never weaker than when we think we're strong. We are never more susceptible to danger than when we think we are safe. As the writer of Proverbs put it, pride comes before a fall. And as Paul wrote to the Corinthians, let those who think they stand take heed, lest they fall. David was not prepared for what was about to happen to him. First of all, he was not where he was supposed to be. And there is already a lesson for us as early as verse 1 of the text I just read. It was the spring of the year, the time when kings are supposed to go out to battle along with the troops. But David sent Joab, his general, along with Joab's officers and troops, into battle while he stayed at home. Apparently, by this time in the narrative, David had reached a point already where he had kind of risen above the battle. He was much too powerful and too important to put himself in harm's way, so he remained in Jerusalem. And we are left to wonder how this story would have turned out if David had just been where he was supposed to be in the first place. How much needless pain we inflict on ourselves and others just because we are not where we are supposed to be. I don't know if you've ever found yourself in that kind of place or position. You look around and you know in your heart that this is somewhere you should not be. And before you know what happens, you're doing something you should not do. This happens to me all the time when I'm on a diet. Somehow I find myself at Krispy Kreme or Taco Bell or the clock. And when I'm somewhere I should not be, it's so easy to do something I should not do. And again, that seems harmless enough if you're talking about gaining a few pounds. But when people's lives are at stake, as they were in this story, it gets really serious, really fast. We are, as the choir sang, by nature prone to wander, prone to leave the God we love, prone to be where we should not be. And if we will listen closely, when we are somewhere we should not be, if we will listen closely, we will hear a rock drop in the water. David probably never set out to do anything wrong, but he was in the wrong place at the wrong time. It was late one afternoon. He was home relaxing, probably minding his own business, maybe admiring the vastness of his kingdom and feeling good about all of his accomplishments. I mean, after all, he had made it big at a relatively young age, and he was on his rooftop basking not just in the warmth of the spring sun, but also in the success of his life, when he casually glanced from his rooftop and saw a beautiful woman bathing, and the rest is history. David used his position of power to summons Bathsheba to his bedroom chamber. She was a woman in a man's world, filled with men's voices and men's power. The text, if you notice, does not even allow us to hear her voice, except one time in her three-word message to David, "I am pregnant." As a woman caught in the power politics and desires of a king, it's not like Bathsheba had a lot of choice when the king sent for her. The king always got what he wanted. At any rate, there's a very important detail in this story. Both David and Bathsheba were married to other people. David was married to a lot of other people. He had many wives and concubines, but Bathsheba had a husband whose name was Uriah, and Uriah was a loyal soldier, ironically out fighting David's battles while David was taking Uriah's wife. And so what started out as a private glance from a rooftop continued with an adulterous affair. David sent for Bathsheba. I want you to go back and notice how many times some form of the word sent is used in this passage. And each time, except in verse 5, the sending is being done by David or at his will. Clearly, David, as king, had the power to just send for people and move them around like they were pawns on a chessboard. The moment David sent for Bathsheba, then his servants were complicit and were involved. Obviously, Bathsheba was involved. Uriah, her husband, was unwittingly involved without even knowing it. Sin's ripple effects have a way of taking us down and taking others down with us. Our sinful choices have the potential not just to destroy us, but also the people around us. David might have thought he was not hurting anyone. He might have thought that no one else would find out about this. But after a while, pregnancy is a little hard to hide. And as soon as the cover-up began, the ripples just kept on multiplying and spreading out. David's cover-up plan involved sending for Uriah and getting him home from battle so he could be with his wife and be deceived into thinking that he was the father of Bathsheba's child. So again, David sent for the unknowing, blindly loyal husband, just as he had sent for his wife earlier. And it would have been a perfect cover-up if Uriah had just cooperated, but he didn't. Wouldn't you know that of all the women in Israel with whom David could have had an affair, he had to pick the one who had a husband of integrity. Uriah refused to be with his wife because he didn't think it was fair for him to have the pleasure of being with his wife when the other soldiers were on the battlefield. So the cover-up continued. Then David got Uriah drunk, hoping that then Uriah would stumble into his wife's arms, forgetting his honor and integrity. But even intoxication could not coach Uriah from his high standards. David, now desperate, ordered Uriah back to the battlefield and then ordered Joab, his general, to put Uriah on the front lines of battle and then pull back the rest of the troops so that Uriah could be killed in battle. And the cover-up continued. As we shall see next week and the week after that, there were still other ripple effects and layers of the cover-up to follow. It all started when David made the decision not to be where he was supposed to be. But it didn't stop there. Being where he was not supposed to be led to lust, which led to adultery, which led to deception and conspiracy, and eventually the death of a loyal soldier. My former pastor, Ansel McGill, used to make this statement frequently. He used to say, "We are judged not so much for our sins, but by our sins." And the longer I live and minister, the more convinced I am of the truth of that statement. It's just another way of saying that sin carries with it an irreversible set of consequences. It sets in motion this sequence of events. And the consequences are multiplied when we try to cover it up rather than just confessing it and repenting of it. Sometimes, according to the Bible, our own sins judge us. And the tragedy is not just that we are judged by our sins, but often other people are victimized by our sins too. The cover-up is worse than the crime because the cover-up always compounds the crime, and it leads to other sins. And just practically speaking, living a life of deception and cover-up is absolutely draining and exhausting. My daddy used to say, "You can always remember the truth." The good news of the gospel is that the grace of God can cover up our worst sins and our most elaborate cover-up schemes. As we will see next week, when David finally just stopped trying to cover up his sins and confessed his sins to the Lord, he found out something that is important for all of us to know. You can never out-sin the grace of God. The scripture teaches us that when we confess our sins, that is, when we just come clean and quit trying to cover it up and make excuses and rationalize, when we confess our sins, God is faithful and more than gracious to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In other words, as horrible as our sin is, God's grace is greater, always greater. We began our service of worship this morning with that song in our hearts. We will end our service of worship with that same song. Here's the truth. The cover-up never really covers up anything where God is concerned. The cover-up only compounds it. The only reality that can cover up our sin is the marvelous, infinite, matchless grace of God in Jesus Christ. That's why every Sunday we extend an invitation for you to give your life to Jesus, to trust Him to cover your sin by His great love and mercy. and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. To trust that God's grace in Jesus Christ is greater than whatever you have done. We also invite you this morning to rededicate your life to Christ and renew your promises to Him. And today, as always, the doors of the church are open to receive you into this church family. And this church family is just made up of sinners saved by God's grace. I will be here at the front to receive you and welcome you as you respond and as we stand to sing Grace Greater Than Our Sin. This morning I want to present to you Barbara Thaxton, who is requesting to join our church in absentia. She is physically unable to be here. Her father is Carl Thaxton, a longtime member of our church, and Barbara has moved back into the area, but like I said, is unable to attend church, and yet she wants to be officially a part of this church family. And she would be transferring her letter from another Baptist church in Virginia. And so if you would receive her as a member of our church and welcome her into our family here at Earl Street, please express that by saying, "Welcome home."
Welcome home.
And I'll be sure that Barbara knows that y'all voted her in this morning. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the marvelous, infinite, matchless grace of God, be with you all now and forevermore.